All right, we have a special guest with us today, and they are going to come and share with us the stories, some of the stories of God's grace. Daniel, could you help me with this podium here? They're called Loving Hands Ministries. I was talking to Pastor Wendell before the second service. I didn't know this. He used to pastor a church over in Punta Gorda. I didn't know that. And so he's been around here a long time and knows probably a lot of people that we know. And it is good to have him with us. I know his sister's here with him today. Good to have her. But they have a ministry similar to Teen Challenge. They deal with people with life-controlling habits and addictions. And one of our own is in the program. Jake is here with us today. It's so good to see him and have him with us today. It's been almost 3 years now since he's been around here. And the last time I knew of Jake, he was in jail. And but I've heard what's going on in his life, and it is good for us to have him here today and share what God is doing in his life. And here's our idea in having them with us today. First of all, they're going to pray at the end of the service for some. You might be here today struggling with addictions or life-controlling habits, or you might know people or have people in your family that are struggling with them. And their testimonies are just faith builders to not give up on them, because we believe that God can set anybody free and deliver anybody. Amen? I mean, we serve a great God. Look at your neighbor. Say, we serve a great God. Just don't forget that. You know, sometimes we go along, live this Christian life, and we forget how great God is, you know? And But they are here with us today, and we want to welcome them. If you could give Pastor Wendell a good hand as he comes. Loving Hands Ministry, so good to have them with us today. God bless you, brother. Good to have you with us. Thanks for coming.
Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And, we were here in first service and had a blessed time. And expecting more of the same, but even better in this service. Amen? All right. I see, too, that my brother Don just came in. So, Don, we're glad you're here, along with Judy. Don is my baby brother, and Judy is my older sister. No, she's not the older one, but she's my beautiful sister. And just to give you a little history, I came from Pennsylvania to Florida in 1967 to pastor the Church of God of Prophecy down on Cooper Street, and stayed there a couple years, and they couldn't take me any longer, so they shipped me out. But in the meantime, my dad and mom came down from the D.C. area where we grew up, and where Don was born, and liked it so well, they said, we're moving here. And so the whole crew, eight of us, sons and daughters and mom and dad, the whole crew moved down. And some were already married, and the married ones moved too. So this is home to our family. My brother owns a business here, Don. And my other brother, Jerry, owns Jerry Wilson Motor Cars over in Charlotte Harbor. And one of my sisters used to own a bridal shop here. One was a mortgage loan officer here in the area. But she moved away. She married this doctor, and he didn't like doctoring in Florida. So they moved to Knoxville, Tennessee. And it's amazing because I was born near Knoxville, but grew up in the D.C. area. And as a boy, I struggled a lot in life. Our dad at that time had an alcohol addiction, and our life was pretty rough in those days. And so I wanted out of that house as quick as I could get out. And at around 15, I took off. I'd been expelled from school because of my lack of cooperation, to say it nicely. And so I got a job that I didn't know what I was doing, and didn't hold that very long. I wasn't stable, of course, and not skilled. As the pastor said earlier, people need to be skilled to be able to accomplish things in life. But I was worse than not unskilled. I was lost. And my sin led me into a lot of trouble. So I was in and out of jail and into alcohol and those kind of issues. And one night, or one Sunday afternoon, it was September the 28th, 1958, a lady bribed my buddy and me to go to church. And the way she bribed us was she bought us a six-pack of beer to get us to go. And that's the truth with my hand up. And that night, I met Jesus, and he'd forever changed me. I became a pastor at 22 years of age, 1962. And I've pastored for a lot of years. And while I was pastoring Calvary Assembly of God over in Palmetto in 1980, the Lord had already burdened my heart with this ministry, this concept of discipleship. I had had the privilege of pastoring in Pensacola, Florida, when I left here, this area. And while I was there, I did some street ministry. I won't go into the details. That led into the opportunity to meet a man by the name of David Wilkerson. And David Wilkerson impacted my life. I've never been the same. Since meeting with him, he heard about me and my burden, and he took me aside, and he had this big touring bus, and he set me down, and he gave me some instructions, gave me his latest book. It's ironic. It was titled, Get Your Hands Off My Throat. And the devil's been trying to choke me to death ever since. But I can still squeak it out by the grace of God. But anyway, I went out from there, and with two other Assembly of God pastors in the area, we were able to organize Teen Challenge Pensacola in 1971. But my bishop moved me the next year, and so I thought, well, that's that. But the burden was still there, and so I got involved in street ministry and jail ministry in the Manatee County area, and from there, it's the rest of its history. That's been 32 plus years ago, and we've seen God do some awesome things. We have two locations. One is in Dade City, Florida. We've been there 22 years, and in the Bradenton Palmetto area for 32 years, and we also have a work in India where we have an orphanage, a Bible college, a Christian school, a K through high school, and we have about 230 congregations under our covering there. In these last 20 years, I've been involved in that. I was there this year and had a great time, and Joe and I are making plans to go this year, coming up in January. We're excited about it because we're building a new church in a community. It's up in the mountains, tribal area, very illiterate people. The chief of the village gave us a piece of land. Even though he's a Hindu, he gave us a piece of land. And now we have the roof on it, and they're finishing the inside, and another few thousand dollars, and it'll be done, and we'll be the only Christian witness in that whole region, even though there's a Hindu temple a quarter of a mile or less away, a large one. But the gospel is going out into that village, and we're seeing God do awesome things there, and we're intending to establish an elementary school in the church, since they have no schooling for their children. So we're really excited to get to go and see the progress It's been 2 years in building. We don't have money to just say do it. So it's been a challenge. But we're thankful that God meets the needs. And we feed 50 children every day, 365 days a year, with the funds we raise here in America. Our ministry is a faith ministry. This is faith life. Our life is faith life. We do not charge a fee for any of the services we provide. I don't believe you can put a price on ministry. And most of the men that come to us, truth is they have nothing left, the vast majority. And in many cases, at that point, the family thinks there's nothing more I can do. And so they withhold for a while and some forever. But some families help us, but it's not a requirement. And so God has met the need through the years, and we're so thankful for his blessing. Well, as you can see, I could talk all day, but I don't want you to hear me all day. I want you to hear the testimonies. So Joe, if you will come, please. Joe is my son in the faith. Actually, I claim all these guys as my sons in the faith. But for this point in my life, he's my beloved favorite son and my best friend. He's the young man who God has raised up to be my assistant. And I'm going to heaven in 23 years. I got that in a prophecy about a month ago. A Spanish-speaking lady came up to me. We had done a service in a large Hispanic church in Miami. It was about 3,000 people. We did 4 services that day, and it was a great time. And this lady came up and said, "I never saw you before, but I saw you in prayer this morning." And she was saying that in Spanish. I had no idea what she was saying. But I got someone that's a friend to say, tell me what she was saying. And she said, "I saw you in prayer. When I came, I saw you here." And she said, "God told me that your ancestors lived to be in their 90s and even beyond." Well, boy, that perked my interest, because several of our relatives lived to be in their 90s, one or two to 100, my grandmother to 104. So I said, "Man, listen to this lady." And she said, "You're not going to die anytime soon. God told me you're going to live to be 97. I said, "Amen." It's in God's hands. That's okay. I'll receive it. But I couldn't wait to get back to the green room where they had us waiting between services to tell Joe, "Joe, I got bad news, buddy. You're going to have to wait a while." But he's kind of bossy already, so I don't know. I might have to sit on the side. But... love you, buddy.
My name is Joe. It's good to be here with you today. I'm 29 years old. I'm blessed to have Pastor Wendell as a father, a spiritual father, a mentor, and even a best friend, as he said. He's been the most godly man in my life, and I really attribute God transforming my life and putting the burden in my heart to share the gospel and help these other men because of the love I've seen in his heart and the sacrifice he's gave. I came here broken. There's nothing in me that would be worth something. At the age of 12, I had gotten into drugs. Began rebelling. My parents had divorced, and I just began being a wild heathen. I got into all kinds of evil things. I didn't realize they were evil at the time. I was a non-believer, so I was very deceived. I got into the goth stage, where I would dress in all black and wear Marilyn Manson shirts, and I'd play with the Ouija boards and many different things that I didn't have a clue what was going on. I would sing these songs that I didn't even know what the words were really saying, and it led into drugs. I began experimenting with many different drugs. I began selling drugs to support my habit. By the time I was 16, 17 years old, I was already selling many different kinds of drugs, many hard drugs. And when I turned 18, shortly after graduating high school, I was introduced to a prescription pain pill that was originally given for cancer patients. That was an Oxycontin. And this was in Indiana. It was back about 10 years ago. And so it wasn't a bit as big as a problem as it is today. And it continued to grow into more of a problem. I said if I could feel like this every day, I'd be content with life. I had bitterness and anger in my heart from seeing my dad angry all the time. And as I tried seeking this high on a daily basis, I became chemically dependent on this drug. My tolerance had grown. I had to start stealing to provide for my habit. At the time, I was working in commercial electrical work, so I was making decent money, sometimes making even on prevailing wage jobs, $29 an hour as a 20-year-old, and was still, I would bring home $1,500 a week almost sometimes, and I would still be broke on Thursday, the day before Friday. I always, no matter how much money I had, no matter how much I had stolen that week, the drugs would always suck up all of my money, and I would always be out of money before I got money the next time. And as I was doing these drugs more and more, part of the side effects of opiates and painkillers and heroin is you nod out when you have too much. And I was a very extremist. I was always an extremist since a young child. And I would be nodding out everywhere I went. I would be nodding out in my dinner. I would have a spoonful or a forkful of spaghetti in front of my face and pass out just sitting there with the fork sitting in front of me. I'd pass out on the streets driving. Me being the only one in the car, I bounced off the median on the interstate in rush hour traffic downtown Indianapolis one time. I would wake up with my car totaled, not knowing how I had even made it home. I would get pulled over for thinking I was drunk because everybody would be calling the police on me because I'm swerving in and out of the lanes. The drug had completely taken over my life, and I started getting arrested, started violating probation, going to jail over and over. Every time I went into probation, it was a scary thought, wondering if this time, was I going to get to come back out and go back to work, or was I not going to be coming back out? And many times I didn't come back out. And finally, I began trying to seek help through the only way I knew at that time, and that was through secular programs, Narcotics Anonymous, Alcoholics Anonymous, and all these programs that the basis was a higher power. So I finally came to the conclusion that there was something out there stronger than me, and this addiction I couldn't control. But as I would get out and I would go into halfway houses and outpatient programs, inpatient programs, jail, drug and alcohol programs, I could never get totally free from the drugs. I'd always find myself back into the muck I had crawled out of. And in 2007, I was in jail and I knew I was going to be there for a long time this time. And I walked into a jail cell. Mind you, I also had been racist because as a young kid, I grew up in downtown west side of Indianapolis, Indiana, public schools, and I was a small, I know I'm short now, but I was really small kid, and I used to get picked on. So I had became racist. That hatred had just stemmed up in me and continued to grow, and I walk in this jail cell, and there's a young man, a black man, sitting on this table, another kid. He was probably 17 years old, shouldn't even have been in the jail, and he said, "I know you. You used to sell dope on my block." And I thought, this is going to be real good because I'm stuck in here now with him. And I knew I was going to be there for months. And I was racist. Remember, I was racist. So I didn't like the kid anyways. God ended up using that man in April of 2007. God spoke through that man and saved my life. It wasn't a chaplain that came into the jail. It wasn't a pastor or a teacher. God began speaking through another drug addict. So you could say in the Bible, a donkey, he speaks through donkeys. He spoke through this drug addict and radically transformed my heart, set me free, gave me a love in my heart that I had never had. Tears began flowing down my face in a jail full of all these convicts that before I had to put on this hard face and act like I was a tough little kid. And God saved me, set me free. I began going out trying to tell people about Jesus. I would go to my friends. I had lots of friends that were stuck on oxys. It's an epidemic. It was even bad then. And I would tell them, look, you can get off them pills. And right away their ears would perk up and they'd turn around. But the second I'd say Jesus, they would turn around and they'd run. They'd probably been scarred by the church as I has as a kid. My parents would take me to church, but it would most of the time be to make grandma happy. They weren't living the church life at home. They'd come into church and expect the church to save their kid, but yet I would see my parents living like they were outside of the church. I didn't hear the Bible at home. I didn't hear them praying at home, and that had no effect on me. And I would tell these people about Jesus, and they always would. It would just always run them away. I fell back into the sin because I didn't have any training. And next thing I know, I'd be at a party and they'd be all drinking. And next thing I know, I'd go ahead and start drinking, and then I'm going to my car, getting a Bible out, sitting around a bonfire, drinking, telling them about Jesus Christ, because I didn't have any training. So when I finally had came to Florida, I ran from Indiana to run from my drugs, run from all that problems I had, and I came to Florida finding even more of the problems, and I began attending Inglewood Fellowship Church in Inglewood, and I would cry out to God, sit in the back of the pews, "You had saved me. Why won't you save me now? Set me free from these drugs." I remember crying out to my grandma saying, "Why am I here? God save me now." I was taken to a Baptist church. So that's the only thing I'd ever heard. And I'm thinking, I'm saved now. Why am I still here to suffer? How many of you feel that you're here still suffering on the earth? Does the devil beat you up? Do you feel like the devil's been all over you? Well, let me give you a good scripture that I learned. Genesis 50:20, where Joseph had been thrown into slavery by his brothers. His brothers threw him into slavery. The devil was trying to hold Joseph down. But he said in Genesis 50:20, when God's plan began to be fulfilled in his life, "As for you, you meant evil towards me." See, the devil means evil towards us, especially us guys. He wants to kill us all. It's just more evident in my life by the way I was living. "As for him, he meant evil towards me." But see, God meant it for the good to come about this day to save many people alive. Now, God has taken me through this ministry, transform me into a disciple maker, not just a disciple. I've learned my purpose of why I'm here. I'm not here to suffer. I'm here to overcome, to be a victor in Christ. And when I surrendered my life to Christ, now I get to disciple these men on a daily basis. I was out there causing hell. I was out there killing people, basically. People should have been dead because of my actions. And now God is using me to save these men, to raise them up, to see a diehard Christian. Because that's what we're called to be, to give it all up. Surrender all and follow him. And this is what God can do when you fully surrender to him. You're going to see some of these testimonies. These men come here broken. I didn't come here to get more of God. I wanted to get off the drugs and alcohol. But Pastor Wendell accepted the call 30 years ago and knows if you bring these men in, these broken, hurting, the ones the world want to throw away, you bring them in, shelter them from the world, let them be washed and their minds be transformed. Romans 12:2 was up on the thing this morning. Be transformed. But see, Romans 12:1 is so important in the Christian's life. Live your life a living sacrifice. And then when you live your life a living sacrifice, God begins working through you and doing things like you see here. And it's amazing what God has done. I've now received my credentials with the Assemblies of God. I've been on multiple mission trips to a society that I shouldn't even, that is a of the devil. And yet God's opened the door for me to go there and bring the gospel to them. And them welcoming me in to bring the gospel to them. And now I get to go on a mission trip and begin my India. I got my 10-year visa to India. So now in January I'll be going to India with Pastor Wendell. And it's amazing what God can do just with a surrendered life. So I want you to hear some of these. Daniel, will you come share first, please?
Praise God. Praise God. My name is Daniel. I'm 26 years old. I've been in ministry now a little over a month. And one of our teachers, we have teachers come in every day in our class and teach the word of God. And one of the messages a few days ago really started to move on my heart as the Holy Spirit started to work in me. And that was the reverence of God. And that's one of the biggest problems that we see in the world today is people don't have the fear of God in them anymore. And that is really one of the stories of my life. When I was out there in the world, I didn't have the reverence of God when I was sitting at home on the computer. I didn't have the reverence of God when I was having those thoughts in my head. I didn't have the reverence of God when someone would cut me off in traffic. See, the thing is, I grew up in the church, going to an Assembly of God church. I'd go to church on Sundays, and then I'd go out in the world and live like a heathen the rest of the week. And God really got a hold of me this time, you could say. My life really started spiraling out of control right after I graduated high school. I had gotten into a really bad car accident when I was 18 years old, and a drunk driver plowed me right into a telephone pole. I was bringing my buddy out of the passenger side. His femur was broken half, and his leg was sticking out to the side. You could see his bone, and injured my neck and back really bad. But like a lot of the guys you'll hear from today, we don't want to give the devil any glory. All the glory goes to God. And basically, after the car accident, I hadn't really started experiencing with drugs up until that point. You know, I had tried marijuana and I had drank. But after that car accident, I had started taking prescription painkillers, Lortabs and Percocets and stuff like that. And, you know, I had to work. So I would work to, you know, support my habit and stuff. And basically, opiates, you continuously build up a tolerance. And it gets, you know, more progressive and progressive. And basically what happened is I ended up advancing into, you know, stronger painkillers. Oxys and Roxys, and you know, when those weren't good enough anymore, I found out that there was something cheaper and you get more for your money, and that was heroin. And I never thought that I'd get to that point in my life, because you know, I grew up going to church, I knew the word, but the truth was I really didn't know who Jesus was, because I would just live like the rest of the world. And basically what had happened is I ended up having to work dead-end jobs to support my habit. I could no longer support my habit with just working a job. So I started selling drugs. I started robbing people, my friends, even my own family. I was at an all-time low in my life, to the point to where I could no longer function without my drugs. And that ended up winding me in jail. I got hit with 5 felony charges, and my first offer in court was 25 years in prison, and God delivered me from that. I only had to do 3 years, thank God. But anyways, upon release, this is actually my second time here in the ministry. I didn't complete it the first time because I didn't want to submit to my authorities and didn't want to submit to God. I still was pretty hard-headed, and I had a lot of pride, but God is continuously working on that with me. And this is my second time, like I said. And basically what had happened was I had went back out in the world and started working again. And I got, this time I ended up getting caught up in alcohol really bad. I was suicidal, to the point to where I didn't want to live anymore. And this was my last hope, my last chance was I remembered Loving Hands Ministry. And I called them, and they ended up accepting me back into the ministry. And basically, I'm here. God's renewing my soul. He's renewing my mind. He's changing me day by day, you know. And I just give God all the glory, and I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that I'm not dead. I'm thankful that I'm not in prison. I'm thankful that I'm watching God work in me in a different way that I never thought was possible. And I give him all the glory, honor, and praise. With that being said, I'll leave you all with this scripture. It's Hebrews 11:6. Now without faith, it is impossible to please God. For the one that draws near to him must believe that he exists and is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Thank you.
One more trip, Al, you saw me.
The funny thing is, my brother Joe here, he actually saw me. I was on one of my lunch breaks, and I was at the store at Circle K buying a pack of cigarettes. And I walked outside. I was having a cigarette, and I see him. I look over, and he's in his truck. And I was like, "Hey, how you doing?" And I could just see. I could tell by the way he was looking at me. He could tell that it was almost like the hurt. I could see the hurt in his eyes because I had strayed away from God again, and I had went off the wrong path. And I could tell, I just knew that was a divine appointment, that God had sent him there at that specific time, because I was in need, and I really didn't know where my life was going or what I was going to do. Because, you know, anybody can go work a dead-end job and live like the rest of the world and serve the world, but the ones that does the work of God are the ones that are truly blessed, and I can see that in this man today.
That was while he was back out in the world. So he was here 2 years ago and got to know him. And then I just happened to be on the west side of Bradenton coming back, stopped at the gas station, and here Daniel was standing outside. You could tell he was hurting, smoking a cigarette in his work outfit. And it's just amazing how God works, because these men come. It's a very rigorous program. A lot of times we will have men leave early, but it's like, I don't know how many times we've been out in public and just ran into somebody that's in the ministry, like God's throwing it in their face, like, look, you know where you're supposed to be. And it happened to me. I was out there. But it's amazing how God works. And then God, through that, sparked it back in him about the Loving Hands Ministries. And it was probably 2 weeks later that I think he called. But Matthew, will you come share, please? Matthew's our longtime veteran. Pastor said in the first service that how he's been here 5 years. So I want him to share with you.
Well, good morning. It's great to be here with you. It's also great to have my Aunt Diane and my Uncle Steve in the audience as well. It's a blessing to be able to be here with you guys. You know, growing up as a kid, I was just like any other kid. By the time I hit middle school, I kind of figured out that I didn't have to do my homework if I didn't want to. And that kind of started my downfall with my education. I started to become rebellious. I just didn't want to do what I was told anymore. I felt like I was at the age where I could figure things out on my own. And because of that, I started to become rebellious and a troublemaker. And I was actually the good kid out of my group of friends. I decided that I would quit going to school and pretty much work the deal with my parents. If I'm not going to school, then I have to work a full-time job. That was pretty much what my dad had said to me. If I'm not going to go to school, then you have to be a man and work a job and make your way and pay rent. So I started working as a teenager growing up, and as time went on, a couple years, I started working in the restaurant business in the kitchen, and for any of you who have ever worked in a restaurant, kind of know the lifestyle that goes with it. It's a nightlife for the most part. You're living day to day. And with that, when you're working in the kitchen, most of the guys who work in the kitchen aren't the best characters. Most of the time, there are a lot of guys that actually are in music, and as soon as they get out of work, they go and play music. And that's kind of where I got caught up in. I got caught up in with some guys that loved music. I love music. It's pretty much in my family, and I got caught up with these guys and was just having fun. Having fun to them, though, was getting high. And because I was included in the group, I started getting high. Now, I had been around drugs. I've seen drugs and the effects of drugs my entire life. I wasn't like held away from them. I had seen what happened to people when they did drugs. And like I said, I was actually the good kid. It took a long time for me to break and actually start getting high. But once it started, it was literally like I just fell off. I got addicted to painkillers and methamphetamines as a combination. And that's a deadly combination. When you get addicted, it's already too late when you realize it. And because of that, I didn't want to be that way, but it was the way to survive. It was fun at first, believe me. If drugs wasn't fun, people wouldn't do it. If it didn't feel good, you wouldn't do it. But it does. You know, we have to acknowledge the truth at some point. Part of me liked it. And because of that, I was in a lifestyle that went with it. And that's not what I wanted to be. My drug addiction drugged me to a point where I could not hold a full-time job anymore. I was stealing from friends, from family, and anybody that I could take advantage of, believe me, I would take advantage of you. I didn't like the person that I had become, but I chose that. And because of the choices that I had made, I had no family around to help me. Though they loved me, believe me, my family would do anything to show me love. I had no friends, because my friends were the closest ones that I could get to take advantage of first. And I had no place to stay anymore. I was homeless, living on the streets for a while, you know? And I did what I had to do to survive. Literally driven by a force that was not me, but an addiction. And because of that, I've wound up in jail many times, in and out of jail many times. And just finally got to the point where it's like a light bulb went on. And I said, what am I doing? This is not me. This is not what I wanted to do with my life. Believe me, I did not say, when I want to grow up, I want to be a junkie. You know, for some of you guys might remember a commercial that was way back in the day that said that. You know, I remember that commercial, and I was a little kid. When I grow up, I don't want to be a junkie. I didn't want to be that, but that's what I became, because I made some stupid decisions and didn't want to listen to the people who were trying to help me along my way. I thought I had it, right? I thought I knew it all. I thought I could handle it. But the fact was, it was all being built up to the point where it's just going to fall on me and crush me and kill me. I got to the point where I had seen God work in other people's lives. Though he had never really worked in my life, I've been around it my whole life. So it was something that was ingrained in me that said that there was a God. And even though I didn't know if he was real or didn't believe in him, I still cried out to God and said one night, God, I don't know if you're real. I don't even know if you care. But God, I need you to save me. And nothing great happened. That night I went to bed. For a month I was contemplating ahead of time that I was going to refill some pain pill prescriptions that I had been doing for a while. And I was going to take too many pills that next day, OD, and just be done with it. I had a plan. I actually went a couple days before that to go see my mom for what I thought would be the last time and just tell her that I love her. I went to bed that night. And the next morning, I woke up to a car door being shut in front of the place where I was staying. And I thought it was my friends coming to pick me up to take me to the doctor. It was an hour away from the time that I was supposed to be there. But it wasn't. It was actually two police officers coming to serve me a warrant. They're there to arrest me. You know, they weren't too happy to see me. I wasn't too happy to see them either. You know, I didn't like police officers at this point in time in my life. You know, because I know what happens when the cops come around. They took me to jail. You know, and it didn't seem like a big miracle at the time, believe me. But something just started happening. I was, you go through a process. It's called processing when you get put into jail. Some lady or some guy comes and evaluates your mental state to see where you're at. If you're super dope sick, if you need to go to the hospital, or if you need to go to into classification. And she asks you some questions, your religious preference. And so I said, Christian. My family's Christian, so I must be a Christian, right? Which wasn't true, but that's what I said, you know. I wasn't a Christian at the time. But I chose religious preference. I'm a Christian. Do you want a Bible? Yes. Do you want to attend chapel classes? Yeah, why not? You know, when you're in jail, you just want things to do. You don't want to just sit there, you know? You're happy to see the sunlight for a while. And so I chose those things. But something started happening. You see, when I got my Bible, I didn't know where to start. You know, I had been I've been taught certain things in the Bible, but it never stuck. I started at the beginning in Genesis. And because of that, I didn't know what I was reading. I didn't have somebody there to teach me. But it doesn't matter. If you're reading the Word of God, it's living and active, and it will change your life. It started changing my life. The desires that I had before to go out and party, to go get high, to do what I need to do to survive, once again, stopped. That was not the person that I wanted to be anymore. My desires changed. There was a shift. Now I want more of this Word, this Bible. I want to know more about this God. For some reason, is changing things. One day, I just stopped cursing in the middle of hundreds of guys that every other word out of their mouth is a curse word. It just stopped. I was facing 15 years in prison because of the things that I had committed. And I deserved every day of it. A chaplain came to me and said, somebody's trying to get you out. Somebody's trying to get you into a program called Loving Hands Ministries. And he asked me, had I received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior? And I said, well, I prayed a prayer with my older brother because my brother loves me and he was saved at the time. He wanted me to pray a prayer with him, maybe in hopes to change my life. But I never really received Jesus as my Lord and Savior, you know? So I said no. And he asked me, do you want to receive him right now? And I couldn't deny it. I could not deny the truth that was happening in my own life at the time. That God was doing something that I can't explain. So it's got to be God. And I said, you know what? I got nowhere else to go. I got nothing else to hold on to anymore. If God is real, he's got to prove himself to be real now because he's all I got. And when I prayed that prayer, believe me, it wasn't about the words because I don't remember them. But it was finally because I turned my heart to face God, to give my whole heart to somebody who gave his whole life for me, who would die a gruesome death for someone like me. And not just that, but he would choose to not just die, to cover my sins, but to rise again. To rise again for our justification, not just mine, but for all of ours. To say that he is who he says he is, and he will do what he wants to do. And I'm so grateful that Jesus Christ has become real in my life. You know, he's the only thing that keeps me going, you know? He's the one who truly sustains a person's life. He is the one who can keep you going. If he decides to take your life, it's your time. That's it. It's God's will. But he can keep you going as long as he wants to, too. And I have to place my faith and my trust in knowing that if Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, and that truly happened, I was not there, so I have to place my faith and all my belief in knowing that is real in my heart, that then I know that God is faithful, and he will do what he wants to do in my life, and he will give me that plan and that purpose, and he will guide my steps the entire way if I put my faith and my trust in him. So I'm so grateful for everything that he's done. I've gone places and done things that I never thought that I would be standing up on stage testifying and preaching about Jesus Christ. I never thought about it. But that's what God's doing. You know, he's doing a great work. He's doing a great work in every single one of our lives if we put our faith and our trust in him. I'll leave you with Hebrews 12:1-2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, and let us look to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorned its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the Father in heaven. Thank you.
Real quick, I just want to present some product we have out there. It's a way we raise funds for the ministry. We have ties, we have hats, and it's all witness wear. So please come check it out. We have t-shirts for ladies and men. And then also we have a new DVD of the men's testimonies. We do have two other groups that are testifying at two other churches, and their testimonies are on here. So please come and grab one if you would like. You can show your sons if this is something you think your sons need to hear, your grandsons, whatever it may be. But my name is Jake. I'm 24 years old, and I've been in the ministry over two and a half years now. Growing up, I did not grow up in a church environment. I did not know who Jesus Christ was. That's the bottom line. I started using drugs at the early age of 7 years old when I was introduced marijuana by my brother, and it progressed from there. At the age of 14, I started using Oxycontin, and I found a good friend of mine overdosing, and he died. Through my teenage years, it just kept going and going and going, and was in and out of jail. I had friends dying all around me. I went to Northport High School. I grew up in the area, and, you know, being a person who didn't know God, who didn't even want to seek God, you know, I didn't even understand the concept of the words that we use in the church today, such as redeemed or savior or being discipled. I had no idea what those even meant. And I found myself in a place where I was going to sell drugs to a 19-year-old girl, and it went wrong, and I drug her with my vehicle about 100 yards. And see, that wasn't who I thought I was going to end up to be. That's not who I wanted to be. But I was in a position to where my heart was so hard, and there was no hope in my life. I didn't understand the concept of a Savior coming here, dying for me, raising that I might live. So I ended up in jail. I was married. I had a beautiful stepchild, beautiful wife, and she was pregnant with my child. I was a junkie. I didn't know how to be a father. I didn't know how to be a husband. I didn't know how to be a son. And so being in this position, I knew one thing, that I had to change. I tried NA, I tried the 12 steps, and it just did not work for me. So I remember sitting in jail, and this young man was in a cell, and he would just stay in his cell every day, and he would be reading the Bible, and I realized that he wasn't cussing, he wasn't down gambling with the guys and doing the things that I was a part of. And so that kind of caught my eye. Previous to going to jail, I showed up to church at a youth group with my wife, and I remember standing there, and it wasn't the word that was preached, because honestly, I don't remember what was even discussed, and it wasn't the music, I don't remember the songs, but what it was young people that were down at the altar worshiping a God that I knew nothing about, and I seen hope in them. See, the name of Jesus describes hope where there is no hope. It describes a Savior to a lost people. It describes light in the darkness. And so when I finally realized that, there was no turning back. I was introduced to Loving Hands Ministries by my wife. It's an 18-month discipleship program. I had no idea what I was getting into. I just knew I needed help. So I showed up. I got accepted. I remember sitting in the courtroom. I was facing prison time. And I remember the state prosecutor was telling the judge everything I've ever done in my life. Since I was the age of 10 years old, any criminal history, and the judge stopped her and said, "Ma'am, I think you should sit down. If I send this young man to prison, he'll just be a worse person." And so I got sentenced to Loving Hands Ministries for 18 months, and I've been here ever since. First service, Joe said, when I first got here, I remember laying in bed, and I remember imagining the 18-month day. And when I could walk out and I was free and just to be a father and everything that God wanted me to be. And it's been over 2.5 years now. And I could have never imagined what God has done in my life. So if there's someone here who might come to church regularly but never experienced what we're talking about. You see, the Bible says, "Who is forgiven much loves much." And that's why these men are so on fire for Jesus. That's why Joe has given his life to a ministry where he doesn't get paid any money. He stays there on campus. Right now, he doesn't have a wife or kids. God is everything to him. And that's how it should be in our lives. And you know, the scripture today that Mrs. Webb had up here, Romans 12:2, Joe touched on it. And that's the key to everything is we are being brainwashed. Now, it sounds bad, but it is true. We are being brainwashed by the Word of God. We are being transformed because everything in my mind was totally contrary to Jesus Christ and everything that he represented. And so now I can stand today and say I'm not that person anymore. I am a father, and I can show my daughter who to be when she grows up. I can begin to disciple my family and be the head of my household as the Bible has called me to be. And so I just praise God for this ministry because it is this ministry that placed me in an environment where God grabbed me to an extent that I could never imagine. So please, if you are here and you might say that you need hope, you might say that, you know, I want that, come talk to us. Please, we'll be willing to do whatever. If you need prayer, we're here. Just come and speak. I'll leave you with the scripture. It's Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Thank you.
So I pray you are blessed today. Just hearing the hope. We come to bring hope, share our stories, our testimonies, to bring you hope that no matter what you're going through in life, Christ is the answer. And please know that you don't have to be a drug addict or a heroin junkie to need Jesus Christ. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're as bad as the pedophile out there, the rapist, the murderer, or the other drug addicts that are shooting up out there. We all need Jesus. He's the Savior, and he came for all of us. So if you don't know Jesus, we pray that you'll come at the end. As Pastor Webb said, we're going to make time to pray. We're going to have the men up front if you need any prayer for drug addiction, if you have any kind of addiction at all in your life, or you have loved ones that have addictions, we'd love to be praying. Leave us also your names, write your name down, and we'll put them in our prayer book and be praying over them. We have intercessory prayer Monday through Saturday around 1 p.m., so we'd love to be praying. And also, you can visit us online, lovinghands.net. Don't wait till next year when we come to stay in contact with us. Get on Facebook and follow us. We love to hear more input and more feedback from you. Thank you, Pastor Webb.
All right. You know, it's interesting to hear these stories. And I think to myself, you know, my mother told me to stay away from people like this. You know, when I was a kid, I avoided people like you. I did. And I say it this way, you know, I got delivered from drugs before I got in them. You know? Yeah, I do. But what's interesting, what the wonderful thing about the church is that God brings us all together. From all different backgrounds, all different, you know, upbringings and perspectives and all those kinds of things. And somehow, some way, he just mixes the whole bunch together and somehow works out his purpose and his will in our lives, don't he? That's why I love the church. That's why I've been in the church my whole life. Because we hear the stories of God's grace. And every Sunday morning, I remember when Jake used to sit at the back, and I used to think to myself, just somehow touch them. Just speak. Somehow, just God, let them know that you love them. And so today, as we celebrate this great ministry and what God is doing in the hearts and lives of, of these folks, these young men, I just joined together and I say, I've seen a miracle. I've said this before. I've said it to Jake when I talked to him on the phone a couple weeks ago. I said, I've seen a miracle in this young man's life. Because when he went to jail, I heard he went to jail. I didn't give up, but I thought to myself, you know what? There's not much hope for him. You know, his background is so messed up and his life is so messed. I can't imagine taking drugs at 7 years old. I can't imagine that. But sometimes, you know, the enemy gets to us when we're younger. Because that's what he wants to do. He wants to get to our children. And that's why we, the church, want to be that beacon of truth and hope in the community that says, God's got a better plan for your life. God's put a gift in your life he wants to use for his purpose and his glory. You know, and it's just up to us to help find those people and tell them that Jesus loves them. Amen. And so today I want us to give to this ministry. We're going to pray in just a minute, but we want to receive an offering for them that God would just help them to continue to touch more and more young people. What do you got? You say you got two other groups in different churches today? So, okay, so they're scattered out all over the place here today, this morning in churches all over the state. And not only are they ministering here, but you know, in India and other places. Bruce, we got to hook up with Brother Wendell and see if we can go with him one of these days. It'd be cool to go to India. Yeah, we'd like to do that, maybe. But we want to encourage you to give as giving unto the Lord so that we can just sow some seed into this ministry. You know, we got family ties here with the Lanaveres and, you know, Jake and with this ministry. We want to just give. We're all a part of one big family. So we want to encourage you to give. Let's pray. Father, bless this offering now and use it to touch the hearts and lives of more and more people, more and more young men, more and more families. And now, Lord, we celebrate what you are doing in their lives. Lord, little girls are going to have a father. Children are going to have a family. And we're thankful and grateful for that today. Thank you for Pastor Wendell, his commitment to this. This is not an easy ministry. It's messy. It's difficult because it deals with the heart. And the heart at times can be dirty and desperately wicked, the Bible says. But Lord, you have raised him up for this purpose, for this time. And we ask you to bless Pastor Wendell, heal his body, touch him, meet every need that he has, Lord. Let him live another 23 years. We say amen to that. Now, Lord, bless this offering. Use it for your purpose in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We appreciate you as you give it. We're going to stand and we're going to be dismissed in a second, but we're going to have them come and pray with us because some of you have family members that struggle with addictions. You might struggle with addictions yourself. And we want to believe that God is going to touch your family or your loved one or your neighbor. And we hear these testimonies and they give us faith and hope, cause us to keep on believing and don't give up on those that sometimes we are tempted to give up on. Amen. And so we're going to pray. So let's all stand. If you're here today and you or someone you know maybe struggles with these addictions, you know, I say it like this, you know, when I was 11 years old, I snorted two lines from this, been wasted ever since. You know, that's the way I say it. That's the way I say it. John 3:16 and 17, you know, when I was a kid. But we want to pray for you and believe God with you. Because God, if He can touch these folks, He can touch anybody. I'm not saying they're terribly bad, worse than anybody else, worse than any of the rest of us. I was a sinner. I needed a Savior too. I'm not here to try to act like I'm better than anybody else because I haven't been perfect either. But we believe, you know, it gives me hope. And when people come and sit on the back seats of our church, it gives me hope and faith that God can touch their life and God can redeem them and set them free and use them for His purpose. Amen. So we want to pray today. And so if you're here today, maybe you or someone you know, we're going to get up close and personal here today. Someone you know deals with addiction or drugs or some life-controlling habit. It might be other things, alcohol or whatever. Would you just raise your hand? We're going to pray. We're going to believe that God is going to meet every need. Yeah. We believe that God can meet every need, that God can touch every life. Amen. We believe that today. And so here's what we want to do. We want to pray. So if you guys would come and stand at the front here with us, those of you who raised your hand, we want you to come and we're just going to believe that God is going to touch you. In the early service, we had people come forward for prayer for them or someone they know, that God would just, you know, touch them by His grace and power. And so we're going to pray today. So let's just join together and agree together with them. If you got to go, you can go. You can be dismissed if you need to. That's okay. We don't want to hold you too long. But we're going to believe that God is going to touch every situation and every need here today. So let's just pray together. Father, we join together this morning. We celebrate, first of all, the redeeming grace of God. We join together and celebrate the love of God for us. That He sent His Son to die on the cross for our sins. Shed His blood that we might be set free from the awful effects of that sin. And Lord, we ask You right now to just touch each and every one of these that are here. Lord, we pray that somehow You can touch those that are addicted. We pray that You could bring transformation to the heart and mind of those, Lord, that we're praying for. Lord, our family members, our loved ones. Lord, we ask You to do a great work in them. We're believing You. We're trusting You. We're calling upon You right now, Lord, to touch and meet these needs in Jesus' name. Because we know that Jesus is able to touch and to heal and to redeem and to set free. And now, Lord, we come into agreement together and we ask You to bless every life and every need. Lord, we pray for those in our church, Jack Magley, Lord, who's going in for some more tests. We pray for Larry Burns and Jennings Millsaps. Lord, we pray for the Frobos' neighbor who had a stroke. We lift her up to You in prayer. It's in Twosett Hospital today. We ask You to touch her body and minister to her. Lord, we pray that You would be with Naomi's family and the loss of her grandmother. Lord, just be with her and touch her. Touch that family, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Marie LaFell's family, Lord, touch them. We pray for the Lana Farah family, Lord, and the loss of Steve's mother, Ann. We pray that You would bless them and touch them, Lord, as we join in celebrating her funeral today at 2 o'clock. We ask You to just be with their family and touch them. And Lord, we pray for this little boy that was hit by a car. It's in critical condition in our community. We ask You to touch him, Lord, and just strengthen his body and meet his need today. Now, Lord, bless us as we leave here. Lord, just cause Your people to prosper and give us hope that Jesus is the answer to every need. And Lord, we say thank you for all that you've done and all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said amen, amen, and amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. If you're joining us for the very first time, we'd love to meet you just in the little room off to the side there, our hospitality room. We have a gift we'd like to give you. God bless you. Thank you for being here. If you'd like prayer, just come up to the front. The team is here. They'll pray with you and they'll believe with you. God bless you. Thank you for being here.